Politicians returned to Parliament yesterday, and of course the main topic of discussion was the impact of Cyclone Gabrielle. One MP, the National Party's Maureen Pugh, decided yesterday was a good time to reveal she doesn't believe in man-made climate change.
It's not what I think, it's what I can prove. I am waiting on the evidence. We have cooled and warmed over millions of years.
But you don't think the current climate change is down to humans?
I have yet to see what the evidence is that they are providing about that.
Pugh reappeared a short while later, though, to completely walk back her comments, saying she regretted that she'd been unclear.
I regret that my comments this morning were a bit unclear and will have led some to think that I am questioning the causes of climate change, and that is clearly not my position.
What was clear was that she'd had a chat to National Party bosses who very quickly dismissed her earlier statements. We're joined now by National Party leader Christopher Luxon. Good morning, Mr. Luxon. What did you say
morning,
to Maureen
How are you
Pugh?
Today?
Very well, thank you.
Oh, look, I mean, you can't be living in the 21st century and deny that human-induced climate change is real. It is real. There's no room for climate deniers or climate minimalists in the 21st century, I just put it to you. That's why the National Government signed New Zealand up to the Paris Agreement. That's why we're deeply committed to net carbon zero 2050. And so, yep, Maureen had a terrible interview. She came back and said, no, you know, she fully understands the science base for human-induced climate change. We had a good conversation. I suggested I also wanted her to do some reading around the subject as well. So, you know, she has a reading list that I've asked her to go through to make sure she does fully understand the science base.
What have you told her to read?
Look, I think a good place is the IPCC 2022 report. I think anything by the Parliamentary Commissioner, Simon Upton, is always very good. My good friend Jonathan Porritt is a leading thinker, and anything by the late, great Sir Rob Fenwick is fantastic. So those are the articles and things that we have assembled for her to look through
as well. But Maureen said she was waiting on the evidence, and as an elected official, would you not expect her to be able to perhaps take her own initiative here and educate herself on man-made climate change?
Yeah, look,
before
I mean,
today?
She actually expressed herself. Yeah, she expressed herself incredibly poorly by her own admission, and in part she was referencing some conversation apparently between the regional council and the minister. That's largely irrelevant. The key thing is that she understands that the science base completely supports human-induced climate change. That's non-negotiable, and so it was good that she came out, clarified her statement.
But she actually walked it back. It wasn't just a clarification. She completely walked back a very clear statement that she'd made the first time, that she would not admit that there was an impact of man on the climate. Is that not a concern for you, that you have someone... I mean, to put it bluntly, she looked a little bit like she was being held hostage at the end of reading that statement where she walked back her comments completely. Are you not a bit concerned that you've had to have this chat to her?
Look, it's frustrating for sure, you know, and she had a poor interview. She didn't express herself well at all. And as a result, we've had a conversation. She fully understands and she fully supports the National Party position and has, because it's been our position for some time in our caucuses, and we've discussed that. She just expressed herself poorly and she's really clear about it. And I just also wanted to augment that so that she could have some different reading and some more reading to actually fully internalise, that understanding that human-induced climate change is real. Period.
She's going to be busy. Is there anyone else in the party who needs a reading list for late nights?
Look, I mean, I'm proud of our track record in the environment with the National Party. You know, we are the party and government that signed us up to Paris. We are the government that is, you know, deeply committed to carbon, you know, net carbon zero 2050, the NDC goals for 2030. We supported the government on the emissions reductions budgets last year. We're deeply committed to it. The means by which we deliver that might be different from this government, but don't doubt our commitment to those goals. And that's been our position from the get-go, and that's certainly been my position as a business leader in the past and certainly as leader of the National Party.
All right, I'll let you talk about something that you'd probably rather move on to. The OCR perhaps going up with the Reserve Bank's decision due on that. What do you think should happen?
Well, look, the Reserve Bank is independent. They have to make their own calls. They're in a very difficult place because we've had a government that's been spending $1 billion more each and every week, a lot of it wasteful, foot on the accelerator, at a time driving a lot of domestic inflation. The Reserve Bank stopped printing money and it's had to put the foot on the brakes hard. This will be our 10th rate rise in less than 18 months. Interest rates will be probably likely up about 4.5% in that period of time. And, you know, really, if you're a New Zealander, already doing it tough with the cost of living crisis. you know, this is another kick in the guts, because essentially someone else, you know, mortgage owners have got to go off and find several hundred dollars a fortnight to pay their mortgage. Just think about it, Anna. You know, in New Zealand, most New Zealanders have fixed rates. It's different from other parts of the world. So in the next 6 months, a third of all mortgage owners are going to move from 2 or 3% rates up to 6 to 7% rates. That's a big, big drain on their budget at a really tough time.
Except that banks have done the calculations to ensure that homeowners can afford these, and there is a need to bring down the pressures of inflation. And it has so far worked. We are starting to crest downhill.
Well, we haven't actually. Our inflation for the last three quarters has remained stubbornly high at above 7.2%. We've had interest rates now moving up, continuing to move up. And the reality is everyone's going backwards because real wages haven't actually increased. People's wage increases a lot less than inflation. It's been like that now for 2.5 years. So your money doesn't go as far as it did. You can't buy as much as you used to be able to. Everyone's going backwards. And it's fundamentally because this government doesn't have a proper economic plan to tackle the underlying causes of inflation.
One last question. The government has announced a $25 million cash grant fund to affected farmers and landowners around the Hawke's Bay region for Cyclone Gabrielle, but they have already admitted it's going to be on a good faith basis and they'll have to audit it later. Do you think that's a good idea?
Well, look, I mean, I think we've got good lessons and playbooks out of Canterbury and also out of Kaikoura, particularly Kaikoura. You know, within 4 days of Kaikoura, there was a very specific targeted short-term wage support for those that had been impacted. And I think it's really important, you know, the learning from COVID was money was just sprayed around. It actually has to be targeted and impacted and get to the people that need it most. My problem is there's not enough specificity and certainty. And, you know, having been on the ground there, if you're an orchardist, Anna, waking up this morning and your orchard's covered in silt and slash, you want to get working. So can you employ or redeploy your RSE workers to actually do that work, or is that illegal? Are you able to pay them when you don't have any revenue likely for the next 3 years as you rebuild your orchards? So if you're a worker, you're going to work today, are you going to get paid? And actually, can you make your rent and buy food this week? You know, that's why we need a very specific, you know, targeted short-term impact for those that have been impacted wage support. And, you know, I want to be supportive and constructive with the government here, and I've tried to do that over the last week. And, you know, really good wage support, getting clarity on immigration settings, making sure the banks stand by them. And if we need some emergency powers to really get this infrastructure built so that you and I in 2 years' time are not having a conversation about 15 bridges not still being built, that's really what matters. We have to get on and get things done, and we have to get people from a place of hopelessness to a place of hope fast.
Oh, well, let's hope the 25 mil goes towards that. National Party leader Christopher Luxon, thanks for your time this morning.